and later born children. So later born children in the sense, the fourth, fifth, sixth or that kind of children, the fourth children or fifth children or sixth children were more. To 20% in families of Perthes disease. There were one family which they found out generations together they developed Perthes disease, and it is associated with hemivertebra, deafness, pyloric stenosis, undescended testes, and short tibia. Because this, why I specifically mentioned hemivertebra, deafness, undescended testes, because all these are hemivertebra and deafness are normally seem to be associated with some epiphyseal dysplasia. So these patients seem to have some kind of epiphyseal dysplasia, or this physis is not developed properly. Okay, it could be hypothyroid or some other problem. They found out the physial cartilage is not developed properly. It is thicker than the normal population, so it is not well developed. So that was the reason why they found out they had some bony pathology along with some vascular malformations or hypercoagulable state. So, and also it is very common in poor socioeconomic status. They are associated with, most often they are associated with trauma. Of course, sometimes we don't get the history of trauma properly. And they found out that these patients have a serum manganese elevated level. They don't know what is the reason. And they, most of the children are either hyperactive or they have attention deficit disorders. And because of the hyperactivity and attention deficit, they are predisposed or prone for some trauma or some injuries. They keep jumping from one place to another. They keep running. They don't know what happened. So, and they're not able to communicate that they had some fall. So they found out that these hyperactive children and attention deficit children developed synovitis, which increased in the, which causes pressure effect, and that also predisposed to Perthes. So the etiology, we all know the various etiologies I mentioned, that could be a traumatic synovitis, repeated joint effusions, cartilage hypertrophy, which I mentioned to you. It could be an epiphyseal dysplasia. It could be hypothyroidism. You know, all know slip capital femoral epiphysis has got a lot of hormonal theories with respect to slip capital epiphysis. But though Perthes don't have a hormonal hypothesis or hormonal causes, they definitely see some hypothyroid cause also can develop this kind of cartilage hypertrophy, and that in turn can cause Perthes disease. And of course, trauma, which I mentioned to you, it's very common. There is a congenital vascular hypoplasia. They are also very common with coagulation defects, and increased steroid intake can also cause Perthes. So, and why it is common between 4 to 7 years? That is very, that's a very common question is asked, and it's a very easy question to answer. We all know up to 4 years, the femoral head is supplied by both the metaphyseal, here you can see the metaphyseal, as well as the lateral epiphyseal vessels. And the artery from the ligamentum teres, which is from the obturator artery, it comes only after 7 years of age. So between 4 to 7 years of age, this lateral epiphyseal artery is the only artery which supplies the femoral head. And it usually comes from the medial circumflex femoral artery, which is the major supply of femoral artery, so of the femoral head. And one thing is, this lateral epiphyseal artery, when it goes, when it has to traverse into the femoral head, it takes a tortuous course between the greater trochanter and the capsule. Okay, so it is somewhere prone in that area where it enters into the capsule from the greater trochanter. And why it is common in males? I told you why it is common in males, because it is a long artery in males, and it is highly prone for constriction at the level where it enters into the capsule, because it is slightly longer. And of course, the male population is more prone for trauma and traumatic synovitis. So it is more common in males, which is because of the nature of the, or the anatomy of the artery, which is different in male population than the female population. And I told you it is not common in black population, because in black population, more than 30 or 50% of the population, the major supply to the femoral head is the ligamentum teres, artery of ligamentum teres. That is an anatomical anomaly, vascular anomaly, but it is common in 30 to 50% of population of the blacks, black population, especially in the African population. And they don't seem to get this kind of Perthes disease. But it is very common in Japanese, I said Japanese, European, Mongoloid race, because this artery is comparatively longer and of a the intimal is intima is also can easily get damaged in this population. So that is why it is very common in Japanese population, the Mongoloid and the European race, especially Caucasians. So this is basically summarizing what happens during the etiopathologies disease. This is an unidentified hypothesis. I mean, this is not a very clear-cut proven one, but it's hypothesis of leukopathies. So it is highly active child who falls on the hip. The fall causes minor trauma to the capital femoral epiphysis. This minor injury in the metaphyseal area induces an increased tendency to form clots. Because I said they have a hypercoagulable state. The child is deficient in either the protein C or protein S. Clotting occurs in the venous system. The venous pressure rises in the femoral neck. And clotting propagates into the femoral head where infarction occurs. And over a period of time, the femoral head becomes more radiodense and all the other changes which I'm going to describe will happen in the pathology. So it is basically minor trauma, hypercoagulable state, and increased venous pressure, reduced arterial supply, which all predisposes to this kind of pathologies. So this is what summarizes the pathogenesis. The idiopathic capital femoral epiphyseus goes for ischemia. There is a temporary cessation of the epiphyseal growth. The epiphysis temporarily does not have any blood supply. We don't know what is the temporary time duration. It could be a very short duration or it could be long duration. And epiphyseal revascularization occurs from periphery. This is slightly different from your AVN where a revascularization is not possible. Here a revascularization occurs. And the resumption of growth and ossification starts. Finally, they end up in two forms, either the potential or the true form. So this revascularization I mentioned can occur in two forms. It can be recanalization or revascularization. So already I said hypercoagulable state, all the vessels are now coagulated. There is no blood supply. So recanalization occurs. So recanalization, if it occurs, it normally goes into the potential form or it is a good prognosis. Because it forms very early. The recanalization happens very fast. It happens within 3 to 4 weeks. Whereas the revascularization is neovascularization. The neovascularization takes normally 3 to 6 months to happen. So they come from the periphery and new vessels, clotted vessels don't supply blood anymore. They completely clotted. The new vessels form, which is the neovascularization happens, which occurs after a long period of time, which is around 3 to 4 months. So this normally goes into a true form of Perthes disease because here you can see the difference, the potential Perthes and the true Perthes. Of course, the potential Perthes has got a good prognosis. There is no subchondral fractures, the epiphyse, no epiphyseal resorption. Whereas here the epiphysis gets resorbed, there are subchondral fractures and it is a painful condition with restricted movements in true form. Whereas there is no deformity and patients are normally asymptomatic and the range of movements are complete in potential Perthes. So the pathology, a little bit of, because I know I'm going more into detail of pathology, because if you understand the pathology, the clinical features, the radiological features, the treatment becomes easier. So this is more, I've gone a little more into basics of pathology. So in pathology, what happens is, there are four changes which happen, four different levels. So there is change in the epiphysis, there is change in the physis, the metaphysis, and the acetabulum. So all the four regions, which is in and around the region of the hip joint, get affected. So what happens to the epiphysis? So there are four stages of epiphyseal changes, which is the avascular. First stage is the avascular necrosis. Second is a fragmentation of the epiphysis. Then it starts regeneration, and then finally it heals. So what happens in avascular necrosis? All part of the bony nucleus, I said, is completely dead. Most of the epiphysis is not supplied. And as the cartilage part of the femoral head, so because now the cartilage of the head and the cartilage of the acetabulum is not vascular supply. They don't have any vascular supply. But what they have is the synovial membrane only will, the synovial membrane is completely giving the nourishment to the cartilage. So now what happens is the cartilage starts overgrowing. Both the acetabulum and the femoral head cartilage starts overgrowing in avascular stage. So now what happens, because the cartilage starts growing, because the cartilage starts growing, slowly the head is, or the femoral head is pushed laterally outside. Because especially the medial part of the acetabulum cartilage and the medial femoral head the cartilage thickens very much. So slowly the extrusion of the femoral head starts. So here you can see what happens is in the avascular stage itself, there are subchondral fractures, which is called the Salter's sign, the crescent sign, or the Kefi's sign. So the three names for this sign, either the crescent sign, which everybody can easily remember, and the Salter's sign or the Kefi's sign, all three are the same. These are the crescentric fractures which occur in the subchondral region of the femoral head. So this happens in the avascular stage itself. And next is the fragmentation stage. So from avascular, next fragments. Nothing but, because now slowly what happens is, because there is no blood supply, the alternate, what happens is, it stage, whatever the head is remaining inside, there is alternate fibrosis and sclerosis, which leads to fragmentation and vertical fissures. And the extrusion of head still continues. But if the extrusion of head is more than 20% at this stage, then it is a bad prognosis. So here you can see the extrusion. So this is a normal, the extrusion is where you calculate the distance from the acetabulum and the medial part of the femoral head. So this is the normal side, which is A. Here you can see the distance. Here you can see the distance B and distance A. So B by A will give you the extent of femoral subluxation. And third stage is the revascularization stage. First I said is the avascular necrosis. Next is fragmentation of the epiphysis. And third is the revascularization. Now peripheral new bone formation occurs. Once the revascularization starts, the peripheral new bone starts, the level of the epiphysis, new bone starts formation. But this new bone is not hard enough. It is susceptible to deformation. And if at this stage the head is not contained into the femoral head, the head starts getting damaged. Or the coxa magna, the mushroom-shaped head, whatever the flattening of the femoral head, anything can occur at this stage. So at this stage, you have to make sure that the head is contained. Okay. Next is the healed stage, where I said the bone starts forming, and this bone starts forming mature lamellar bone. Initially, it was not a hard bone; it was a very soft bone. I said it can get deformed. Once the stage of healed, the dead bone is completely replaced by mature lamellar bone, and the complete the process of epiphyseal pathologies is start of ending at this stage. Okay. And next is, I said, the metaphyseal changes. The metaphyse is very simple. Metaphysis widening occurs because the epiphyse, the physeal damage is there. The physis starts widening. Okay. And it starts thinning and widening. So as the physis widens, the metaphyseal also is widening. And there is osteoporosis at the metaphysis and cyst formation. There are two types of cysts, which is a pseudo cyst and a normal cyst, but both the cysts are one is continuous with the physis, and that is a true cyst which is continuous to the physis, and the false cyst which occurs only at the metaphyseal level. So don't bother too much about the metaphysis, not many changes except for the widening of the metaphysis. And of course, the physis, I said, the physis also gets damaged. There is ultra structural damage which happens at the level of the physis. There is a premature fusion of physis. So what happens is, because the physis gets prematurely fused, the neck gets foreshortened. The femoral neck will not grow, and the neck will get foreshortened, and when it will reduce the linear growth of the patient, and the linear growth of the neck will stop. So the overgrowth of the greater trochanteric physis happens because this physis of the femoral head is not nourished properly. The physis of the femoral head stops, but the greater trochanter starts growing uncontrolled or unhindered. So because of this, what happens is you get a coxa varum. Because the trochanter grows, there is foreshortening, there is a coxa vara, because the neck shaft angle gets altered and a coxa vara happens. This alters the mechanics of the head, where a Tundelenburg gait and all the signs of your coxa vara or Perthes will start appearing. And of course, the acetabulum also is very important. I said initially the thickening of the acetabular cartilage happens, and a double acetabulum forms. The medial part or the inferior part of the acetabulum will seem to form a joint, and the superior part of the acetabulum also will seem to form a joint. It's called as a double acetabulum. And the acetabulum will become steep because the head is now altered in shape. The acetabulum will not have the normal curved contour, and it will become more steep. And the loss of acetabular coverage happens because the head is subluxed outside. The acetabular coverage also will be less. So these are the few. Take a look at this diagrams very carefully. Here you can see the head is altered. So this is the maximum diameter of the head. Suppose the vertical diameter and the horizontal diameter are the same, then you can say the head is not altered. But here you can see the head is very clearly altered. It is normally the horizontal diameter which you take into consideration. Okay. Suppose the horizontal diameter of the affected head is more than 10%. Opposite review, you have to take the horizontal diameter, and if it is 10% more than the opposite side hip or the normal side hip, then it is considered as coxa magna. Okay. And there are certain other points which can be noticed here. Normally, what you do is you take a straight line and draw from the highest point of the trochanter. Normally, you reach the center of the hip. Okay, this is the center of the hip normally which we reach the center of the hip. So, but here what they do is they mark the head into four zones: 1, 2, 3, 4. Normally, it should be between 2 and 3. This line should be between the zone 2 and 3 here, or at the level of 2.5, which is considered as normal. Suppose the head is altered or the head is flattened, then this trochanter is going to be higher at the higher level and the head is going to be at lower level. And then that is also a form where the head is deformed. Okay. And about going with respect to the acetabulum, this is the acetabular angle of sharp. So this is called the acetabular angle of sharp. I'm not very sure of the normal. I think it's around 40 to 45 degrees. I'm not very sure. I've not done a reference on that. Okay. So this is the acetabular angle of sharp. In Perthes, what happens is it becomes more steep because this is it becomes little flattened like that and becomes steeper. And the one more thing is, I mentioned about the lateral subluxation or the lateral subluxation of the femoral head. So what happens here is you can see the head is subluxed outside. So you draw two lines. One is at the level of the acetabular edge, and second at the level of the edge of the head. So this angle you draw is B, and this angle you mark is at this distance you mark it as B and A, and B by A into 100 will give you the coverage of the head. If it is more than 20%, the coverage is more than 20%, that's what it is on the opposite side, and this again is going to give you a very bad prognosis. So based on these pictures I showed you, it's a very important classification which was given by Stuhlberg. It was given very early. I think it was in 1960s or 1970s when Stuhlberg gave this classification. It came in JBJS. So he classified the femoral head into 5 types based on this. So what is this? One is a completely normal hip. That is, it is a spherical congruence. So he mentioned 3 type of congruence. One is spherical congruence. Second is aspherical congruent. Third is aspherical and acongruent. That is, 1 and 2 are normal spherical head and they are congruent. Okay. But 1 is completely normal. The shape is completely normal. Whereas 2 is a spherical head, but it is associated with coxa magna or a shortened neck or a steep acetabulum, or any of the 2 or any of the 3 can be present. So 1 is a completely normal hip, which is a completely spherical head, which is not associated with any of the 3 findings. Type 2 or class 2 is a normal spherical head, but it is associated with coxa magna, a shortened neck, or a steep acetabulum. Class 3 is a non-spherical head, okay, but not a flat head. It is non-spherical, but not flat. And it can be associated with any one of the 3 findings. And class 4 is a flat head. It is not spherical, or it is not non-spherical. It is completely flat. However, other changes like coxa magna, neck shortened acetabulum, steep acetabulum. Whereas class 5, there's a slight difference. Class 5 should normally be a flat head and with other changes. But it is slightly different here. Class 5 is a flat head without any other changes. A foreshortening of the neck is not there. There is no coxa magna. There is no steep acetabulum. It is a completely incongruous. Here, what happens is, there's some kind of in class 3 and class 4, there's some kind of adaptation of the acetabulum with respect to the femoral head, which delays the osteoarthritis slightly. Whereas in class 5, the head is completely flattened and there's no corresponding changes in the acetabulum, and the head goes for, or the joint goes for osteoarthritis very early. So this is basically to describe the femoral shape of the head and the acetabulum and the other changes, and classify them according to Stuhlberg's classification to find out which type goes for early osteoarthritis. So next is the clinical features, because already most of us will be knowing what are the clinical features. There is some, when they present to you, maybe they have some kind of history of trauma, or they don't have, we don't know. And they usually present with a painless limb. And they can also present with pain, which is increased by activity and decreased by rest. It is purely at the time where they present to you, with how early or how late they present to you. A slightly later perthes will not present with that much of pain. They would have had a history of painless limb. And usually these children are hyperactive. And you can see they are, in comparison to their peers or in comparison to their siblings, they are smaller in stature. And of course, the other signs, those are symptoms that I mentioned. The signs normally are, they are short stature. They have gait abnormalities, which will come later. Of course, the Trendelenburg gait is very common. Or initially, they used to have a, they can also have an antalgic gait. There is severe wasting of hamstring, quadriceps, and gluteus. There is antalgic or a Trendelenburg gait. There is greater loss of motion. That is, because it is a coxa vara, by definition itself, is there is reduced abduction and internal rotation. But adduction contracture, though adduction contracture may be there in later cases, they usually have an increased adduction and external rotation. Thus, the range of movement is the same. The range of movement, total movement is the same, but the abduction and internal rotation is restricted. In correspondingly, what happens to the external rotation and adduction? They normally increase. But as they go into the stage of arthritis or osteoarthritis, then the picture completely will be of a totally different. And there's one important sign, which is the gear stick sign. Normally, what happens is the trochanteric epiphysis overgrows. So because trochanteric epiphysis overgrows, when you abduct, it goes, hitches against the acetabulum, and the abduction is restricted here. But in gear stick sign, once you flex the hip, and then you do abduction, here the abduction will be slightly more than in extension, because the trochanter will not go and hitch against the acetabulum or the pelvis. The acetabulum, it will not hitch against the pelvis, and so it's henceforth in flexion you will get a more abduction. So this is called the gear stick sign. It's very classical of Perthes disease. And of course, the clinical test, we all know the Trendelenburg test is very classical here. I don't think I have to explain about the Trendelenburg test, which we've already done in class. And there is decreased internal rotation, abduction. Thomas test will show a 15% FMT. Normally, the difference between Perthes and slip capital epiphysis are both a restricted abduction, internal rotation. There is a 15 degree loss of Perthes disease usually. And there is a true shortening of around 2 centimeters. So, coxa vara, by definition, is a restricted abduction and internal rotation with true shortening. So here there is abduction and internal rotation restriction with the true shortening. The difference between slip capital femoral epiphysis and Perthes disease is, here there is a, usually there is a loss of flexion, whereas in slip capital femoral epiphysis there is a increased extension. That is because of how it gets dislocated, the head, how it slips, because there's a posterior slip. Obviously, there will be an increased extension. So this is just about the antalgic and Trendelenburg gait. I don't want to go into details of the antalgic and Trendelenburg gait. You all know, in Trendelenburg sign, there is a sound side will sag. Okay, so you just keep that. The sound side will sag. And antalgic gait, already I've done that. Maybe we'll have a different session with only gait. So investigations, very simple. For any orthopedician, I think this is the battery of investigations for any orthopedician is available. X-ray, AP and frog leg view, CT scan, arthrography, bone scan, MRA. And of course, there is a lot of confusion regarding frog leg view. In fact, the frog leg view initially came for Perthes disease. It was described as early as 1910s and 1915s when, for these kind of Perthes disease, when they wanted to take a lateral view, they were very comfortable taking a frog leg lateral view. So the frog leg lateral view was taken in 45 degree of abduction of hip with 30 to 40 degree flexion of the knee. Initially, when they're done, there was no flexion of the hip. It is not described. I don't know how it is being done now, but frog leg view is 45 degree abduction with 30 to 40 degrees of knee flexion. So you take a AP view and a frog leg view, because it's very difficult to take a lateral view. So CT scan, arthrography, not much significant now. Of course, bone scan and MRA, which are available, can definitely give you a lot of information regarding your Perthes. So ultrasound, I don't think gives a lot of information. Of course, if there is any synovitis, very early stage of synovial effusion, maybe you can pick up some effusion in the joint. So X-ray, again, there are early radiographic changes and late radiographic changes. So these were initially described by Waldenstrom, as I was telling you, the joint space widening, which you can see because the cartilage is thick. The acetabular cartilage as well as the femoral head cartilage on the medial side becomes thicker and the head gets subluxed slightly lateral. So this gap, which is only the cartilage, is not seen in the X-ray or not visualized in the X-ray. So a joint space gap is seen on the medial side, which gives you a joint space widening. But the earliest sign is this small femoral epiphysis. So joint space widening is not the earliest sign. The small femoral epiphysis occurs much earlier than your joint space widening. And of course, there is sclerosis of the femoral leg with sequestration and collapse. I already told you because the early signs are the physeal changes. I already mentioned to you there is a avascular necrosis, there is a fragmentation, there is a regeneration, and there is a healing stage. So these healing stages of the femoral physis will femoral epiphysis will give rise to the sclerosis and sequestration. So here you can see the small. Here you can see the X-ray where the small femoral, the femoral head is seen, which is a smaller femoral nucleus. And of course, the gap also is definitely widened. Here you can see this distance. And here it's much more clear in this. Here the distance, the medial gap is the increased this is the Waldenstrom sign or increased medial joint space. And late radiographic changes. Subchondral fractures that can be partial or can be total. There is coxa magna, which is the head changes, which I already mentioned, a lot of head changes, which I told you. The cystic changes, which are only signs of resorption and also maybe signs of revascularization, which occurs, which gives rise to a lot of cystic changes in the metaphysis as well as the acetabulum. So these are the other late radiographic changes here. You can see the head is completely destroyed here. It is an all distorted head here, and it is completely outside. Here you can see the coxa magna, the foreshortening of the femoral neck, the typical coxa vara is seen here, and of course the coxa magna is seen, and the signs of arthritis also seem to have developed here. So these are all late radiographic features. And here you can see the fragmentation, and here you can see the fragmentation of the femoral head, widening of the metaphysis. You can see very clear metaphysic changes. This is widening, and there is also a diffuse osteoporosis at the level of the metaphysis. A metaphyseal cyst can also occur in the metaphysis, which is not seen here. And of course, there is a classification based on Waldenstrom, which I told you, Waldenstrom gave the radiological features. So he classified this Perthes disease based on his radiographic findings. There is initial, there is a fragmentation stage, there is reossification and a residual. So let's not go into much details of this classification because this is a little older classification, not much of use now. And of course, there's one important sign, it's a sagging rope sign, which normally they ask in MCQs, they ask in, even your X-ray also they can ask in exam. And a sagging rope sign is not a head at risk sign. Most of you come out, once they ask head at risk sign, immediately you say sagging rope. Sagging rope is not head at risk sign. Here you can see this tense sclerotic rope-like sign here. This is a sagging rope. It's nothing but the edge of the femoral head, because it's a larger head now. What you can see is this border of the head, which is seen much lower, because normally the head should be seen upper level. But here, because it's much larger, something like a mushroom-shaped head, the edge of the femoral head is seen as a sagging rope. The sagging rope only states that the head is altered in shape or there is a coxa magna. So next is the few angles gives a lot of prognostic significance. You can see here can be drawn to a perpendicular, which goes to the center of the head, or it can be also drawn through a Perkins line, which goes through the edge of the acetabulum. See this angle and this angle are the same. So it can be drawn either ways. So this angle is same, this angle is same. So hence, this angle is the center edge angle of the Weiberg. And here, similarly, when this angle shows this picture, because normally the center edge angle is drawn with the center, a vertical line which goes to center of the head, and the edge of the acetabulum. Between these two lines is the centered triangle of Weiberg. So normally it is more than 30 degrees. When the head becomes flat, this head goes up like that, and this angle is going to get reduced. So 20 to 30, more than 30 degrees, you've got a good prognosis in Perthes disease, or it is normal. In 20 to 30 degrees, normally it gives a good prognosis, and less than 20 degrees, it is a poor prognosis with central angle of Weiberg. And another one important thing is the articulo-trochanteric distance. Okay, so this distance, here you can see, I told you already, this trochanter, you draw a line over the trochanter, and draw a line on the parallel to the this line or the acetabulum. So these are the two lines. So as there is more arthritis, what happens? This line will get closer and closer. So the head is destroyed, head is deformed, or if there are arthritic changes, this distance gets reduced and the articulo-trochanteric distance gets reduced. And this is condition where there is severe arthritis. So based on this, again, you can classify how severe or what is going to be the prognosis of Perthes disease. So centered triangle of Weiberg is one. Another is the articulo-temporal distance. And another one is the Moser circle, which normally we see it is given in your, So Moser circle is nothing but concentric circles. So these concentric circles are placed over the femoral head, and AP and lateral, both are taken. So if it's less than 2 mm of a sphere, it is good prognosis. If it is 2 to 6 mm, that is the alteration in the diameter is between 2 to 6 mm, it is ovoid. And if it is greater than 6 mm, it is completely deformed head. So the Moser circle also gives a radiological indication. So Moser circle is another criteria. And of course, 28 concentric circles of 2 mm difference. Okay, so there will be 28 circles in Moser circles. It's 2 mm difference. And the 2 mm, less than 2 mm, it is a sphere. If it is between 2 to 6 mm, then it is ovoid. And if it is greater than 6 mm, it is a deformed. And the Fulford criteria is another one, which is not very commonly used. A foreview, I don't know. It is completely theoretical. I could not get a full thing about the Fulford criteria. And this is the Salter's extrusion index. So this is another one important index, where you can a perpendicular is drawn in the center of the femoral head, where it is supposed to be a center of the joint. And another line is drawn at the edge of the acetabulum. And another line is drawn to the center of the femoral shaft or the center of the femoral diaphysis. You just see where this line is. So if it is between these two, if this green line is between these two, it has to be somewhere here. If it is between these two, it has got a good prognosis. Once it comes out, then it is a poor prognosis. So I already mentioned to you, more than 20% of the subluxed head is going to give you a poor prognosis. So, and Salter's extrusion index, and of course, arthrography, I don't think not many people are using arthrography now. It gives you the size and shape of the articular cartilage, okay? And diagnosis, a potential form of, if it is size and everything is normal, then it's a potential form of Perthes, to find out how congruence the joints are, and mainly useful in finding out hinged abduction. Hinged abduction, I'll mention a little later. So this is an arthrogram, which I don't think which gives any much, not of much practical significance now. So MRA, definitely, it gives you a very early MRA, will pick Perthes very early. So joint effusion and synovial hypertrophies are usually seen. And advantages, it is early modality, early stages it can pick. And the configuration of the acetabulum and also the head of the femur can be very clearly seen in MRA. And see whether the femoral head is contained or how much of the femoral head is subluxed or contained can be very clearly seen in MRA. And find out whether deformed head, the head is deformed, then it is definitely a contraindication for osteotomy. A femoral osteotomy cannot be done with a deformed head. So if it is even acetabular osteotomy cannot be done for deformed head. So in these conditions, normally to find out whether the head is deformed, you can do a MRA, and also to find out the level of subluxation. So bone scan, again, can be very useful. I already told you there are two kind of revascularization which happens. One is the recanalization, which gives a good prognosis. It can be very clearly seen in bone scan. And another is the revascularization, where it comes from the neovascularization, happens from the periphery and gives a bad prognosis. So these two can be very easily picked out by these bone scans and give you a idea about what is the prognosis of the problem. So, of course, a lot of differential diagnosis. Multiple epiphyseal dysplasia is a very common one. Okay, already told you, it can be a part of the multiple epiphyseal dysplasia syndrome also. And of course, traumatic dislocation of hip, conditions providing AV. If you're going to produce little later, at a little later age, then you can take AVN as one of the differential diagnoses. Hypothyroidism and Marquio's syndrome, Marquio's disease. These are some mucopolysaccharide deficiencies or diseases which can simulate or which can look like these kind of Perthes disease. And of course, synovial chondromatosis. And another is also a later stage chondroid damage or cartilage damage can also idiopathic chondrolysis, that is cartilage damage. The idiopathic chondrolysis also can present as a differential diagnosis for Perthes disease. So this is one of the Marquio's disease which can also present. And of course, the classification, there are a lot of classifications. It is mainly based on the radiographic findings to predict the severity of the disease and how properly to manage the patients. So these are the various classifications. Don't read all the classifications. It's better to read either one or two. Whichever you are confident, I'll mention all of them. But in exam, you make sure that you read at least one or two, which is the easier, which is easily reproducible, which you always remember. So these classifications are there. The catarrhal classification, of course, the anterior part of the epiphysis alone is involved. And catarrhal B, more than one fourth to one half of the epiphysis is involved. And group 3, 3/4 of the head is involved. And the head is at, or the head at risk signs are present. Okay, in group 4, the whole epiphysis is completely sequestrated. So this is catarrhal classification. So I mentioned the head at risk sign. So there are actually 5. Normally, is any 4 is enough. But metaphysis says, some books say that is also a part of the head at risk sign. But others say, a few books say no. So what are the 4 important points for head at risk signs? There is a lateral subluxation of the femoral head, which already mentioned. There is a gauge sign. There is a gauge sign. Sorry, I cannot take a photograph of this gauge sign because I did not have much time. So there is a radiolucent V-shape. There is a radiolucent. There is a lysis of the lateral aspect of the epiphysis. Okay, there is a V-shaped lytic area over the lateral aspect of the epiphysis. That is called as a gauge sign. Just make a note and just see any pictures that you can easily remember. And there's calcification lateral to the epiphysis. The calcification occurs lateral to the epiphysis is again head at risk signs, which says the head is completely subluxed outside, and because it is subluxed outside, there are a lot of calcification is happening at that stressful areas, and a horizontal fascial line. Normally, the fascial line is not horizontal; it's more angulated. So here, when the epiphysis or the fascial line becomes horizontal, that is also a head at risk sign, and the metaphyseal cyst. Few books says. It is, few bits don't include them as head at risk sign, because all these head at risk signs will give you an immediate management or some kind of containment of these heads have to be done, or they're going to go for a complete or a irreversible damage. So catarrhal calcification normally is, so it's a lateral calcification or the head at risk signs. Calcification must be occurring within the epiphyseal cartilage. Okay, this signals a sign of regeneration, whereas in head at risk sign, the calcification occurs lateral to the epiphysis, indicates the epiphysis is enlarged and possibly flattened also. And this suggests that this sign is not really a sign of head being at risk, but rather a sign that head is also distorted. Though head is already distorted, it is not a head at risk sign. It shows that head is already destroyed and it is distorted. And the lateral subluxation I mentioned, if epiphyseal extrusion is more than 20 degrees, there is high chance of deformation of the femoral head. And lateral subluxation, again, telling the epiphyseal extrusion is regarded as one of the most important factors that contribute to deformation of femoral head. So lateral subluxation is the most important point in head at risk sign. And of course, the Harrington lateral pillar, there are 3 classification A, B, and C. There's no loss of height in group A. The head is completely spherical. There's no loss of height. In group B, there is less than 50% loss of height. 50% of the head is all right. Only the 50% head is collapsed or flattened. In group C, Of course, if more than 50% of the head is collapsed. So here you can see group A, B, and C on Herring's. This is called as a Herrington. I don't think it's Herrington's. Herring's lateral pillar classification. Here you can see the head is spherical. Here less than 50% of the head is flattened, whereas the completely head is more than 50% head is completely, it is flattened. So lateral pillar classification is easier to always, you know, reproduce. Early stages also can be found out. There's better predictability. It requires only AP view and it's highly reproducible. It's very easy to remember. A, B, C, that's all. It's very easy to remember. So next is the Elizabethtown classification. I don't want to go into the details of this. Then is Salter-Thompson. This is again very easy. So this is just A and B. Less than half of the capital femoral epiphyse is involved. More than half is involved. The A, B, C, it's only B and C. It is less than 50% or more than 50%. Here you can see the crescentric fractures or the crescent shape. If it is less than 50%, it is Salter A. If it is more than 50%, it is Salter B. So, of course, these are the clinical course of the disease, which everybody, I think, they will present at different stages. And of course, based on this, what stage they're presenting, the clinical features also are going to completely vary. So the classification is used for outcome. There are two other classifications which I already mentioned, is the Moses and the Stuhlberg. The Moses is based on centroid angle. Normally, it is greater than 30 degrees. But he says if it is greater than 20 degrees itself, you get a good outcome. A fair outcome if it is 15 to 19 degrees, less than 15 degrees centroid angle, then it is a completely poor outcome. This is based on centroid angle by the Moses criteria. And Stuhlberg, of course, already we have done enough. I don't want to go into much of all these criteria. So just want to mention the name so that already I mentioned group 1, group 3, group 4, group 5 of Stuhlberg. Already I said that is a normal head. Second is a spherical head, but not second is a spherical head. Third is it's a flattened head. Fourth is flattened head with three of acetabular changes, femoral neck changes, and head changes. And fifth is the acetabulum is normal, or the other changes are not there. Only the head is completely it is flattened. So here it just shows the evolution to the stage of arthritis. How fast this Perthes is going to progress towards arthritis. So treatment, there are a lot of other aspects, surgical aspects. I don't want to go into details of all that. There is basically it is conservative or it is surgical. So usually, most often, the Perthes disease when they present to you at young age, it is only going to be conservative. Most of the time, you're not going to keep the knife on the patient except for some specific conditions where you're going to operate. Okay. So there is going to be a conservative, there's going to be a containment, and there's going to be a salvage. So these are the three things, these options of treatment which are going to take in hand at which point of time this patient is going to present to you. Okay, there's conservatives usually the early stage, less than 6 years. They don't have much problem in radiological features are not there and the head at risk signs are not there. You feel they're going to have good prognosis. These are only potential form of Perthes. They're not going to go into a stage of osteoarthritis or the head is basically contained. They don't have many other complications. Then you give them bed rest. You give them traction to avoid the synovitis. Just to relieve the pain of synovitis, you give them traction. And usually it is a bilateral traction or the patient will develop a fixed abduction deformity. So there is not much active treatment. It's called as a benign neglect. Okay, and bracing with weight bearing. So these are some braces. Okay, simple longitudinal traction, which I'm just mentioning here. And of course, containment is both surgical and non-surgical. These are lot of braces are present. You just keep a note of, make a note of these braces. And if you want, you can go and read. This Atlanto-Scottish right brace, Newington brace. There is a Birmingham brace. There is a Toronto brace. I don't want to go into details of what are the specifications of each brace. I think you can go and learn. Just learn one or two braces for you so that you can remember. You try to make a picture, draw a picture so that you remember all the features or the specifications of each brace. And of course, surgical, again, usually less than 5 years or less than 7 to 8 years, normally you don't need a surgical management. But when they present you between 7 to 12 years, it might need it. If it's more than 12 years, of course, it's not at all justified because already the damage has happened. So you have to wait for the osteoarthritis to completely set in and then go in for some kind of a total hip replacement or a completely salvage procedure sometimes might be needed. Less than 6 years and more than 12 years in Persthi's disease don't have much of a containment surgery. There is no reason you have to do containment surgery for less than 6 years or more than 12 years. So it's only between this age group that you have to take a decision based on the radiological findings. So containment surgery in stage 1 not indicated. Stage 3 and 4, 2, 3, 4 may be indicated. Okay. So again, containment surgery, when it is stiff, okay, when the hip is going to be very stiff, there is no movement at all, don't go for any containment because you're going to cause more damage. Okay, so if it is full, containment surgery, when the range of movement is full, it is definitely indicated. Internal rotation alone is restricted. Still, you can go in for a containment surgery because that's when you can do a derotation osteotomy and you can get the head contained. Okay, so containment surgery is goals. The goals of treatment are fourfold: to reduce the irritability of the hip, to restore and maintain hip mobility, to prevent the head from extruding. That is the most important point. Head, the extrusion of the head is being brought back inside and it is contained in the acetabulum cavity. And because these are kind of plastic kind of heads, these are not rigid heads like adults, this head can change its shape. And most often when we see, when the head is contained inside the acetabular cavity, as they grow up, the plastic molding does occur and they seem to form at least a very close to or near spherical or near normal head. Okay, so a lot of surgical choices. Again, so surgical choices, I think you can go and read, or we'll have a separate discussion about the osteotomies. And of course, it can be a femoral osteotomy, it can be acetabular osteotomy, or it can be in a combination both a femoral and acetabular osteotomy. So most often, in all the other cases, most often it will be a valgus osteotomy. Whereas Persthi's disease is one condition where you do a varus osteotomy. The idea of doing a varus osteotomy is you want to contain that because it's already outside. When reduce neck shaft angle, already neck shaft angle is reduced, but still you want to reduce neck shaft angle and you want to contain the head because you want to maintain the sphericity of the head. So it can be combined with other procedures like acetabular osteotomy, a trochanteric epiphyseodesis, because the trochanter is overgrowing. So there are so many other surgical procedures. I think we'll